हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम बैक टू माय चैनल बिकमिंग प्रोएक्टिव विद सौम्या अग्रवाल। सो दिस इज द लेक्चर नंबर 1 फॉर चैप्टर नंबर 5 ऑफ स्ट्रैटेजिक मैनेजमेंट बिजनेस लेवल स्ट्रैटेजीज। इन चैप्टर नंबर 1 वी हैव स्टडीड 3 डिफरेंट लेवल्स। 1 वाज योर कॉर्पोरेट लेवल, 2nd वाज योर बिजनेस लेवल एंड 3rd वाज योर फंक्शनल लेवल। We will study the rest of the chapters after this, but this chapter is comparatively smaller than all other chapters, so that is why I am picking the chapter number 5. So let's just have a quick glimpse of the chapter's overview. So in this chapter, basically, there are two parts. First are your Porter's 5 forces, and then second is your Porter's business level strategies. Okay, Michael Porter generic strategies. We also call them Michael Porter's generic strategies. And there are 3 basic broad categories of generic strategies, among which one is your cost leadership, second is your differentiation strategy, and third is your focus strategy. Also, one business level strategy is your best cost provider strategy. So your chapter is subdivided basically into 3 parts. First, we will study about the forces, then we will study about the Michael Porter's generic strategy, and then we will discuss about the best cost provider strategy. Okay? So, what are forces? Forces of model competitive analysis, Porter's 5 forces model competitive analysis. So, what is this about? See, Michael Porter, what did he do? He said that if you want to come into the market, okay, if you want to, you know, come into the industry, then you should be aware of the effect of the 5 forces on your particular business. Okay, so what did he say? He said that first of all, you should be aware about the competitive pressure. Then you should evaluate the strength of the pressure. And then you should determine that what collective strength of the 5 competitive forces is and whether you will be able to earn adequate profits or not. Matlab inhone ye bola, industry mein aane se pehle aap 5 cheeze jo hain, 5 forces jo hain, unka effect dekho. Theek hai, fir uske baad mein ye dekho ki wo kitne strong hai, unka kya effect hai, aur fir uske baad mein ye dekho ki kya un forces ko face karne ke baad mein bhi aap adequate profits earn kar paoge ya nahi. Now, what are these 5 forces which Michael Porter is talking about? And I am expecting that you will read these 2 paragraphs by yourself. Okay. So, these 5 forces are competitive pressures associated with market maneuvering and jockeying for buyer patronage that goes on among rival sellers in the industry. So, this simply means that your competitors, that your rivals, okay, there are lots of people or lots of competitors in the same industry. So, first force is about them only. That in the industry, in the same industry, who are the people from whom you have to compete? Okay. Now, the second pressure, or you can say the second force, is the threat of new entrants. Someone new is coming into the market. Someone new is coming into the industry. So, that particular new entrant can be better than you. Okay, and if that particular new entry will be better than you, then your customers will shift through that particular new entry. Okay, so this is one of the threat to new entrant. So second force is your threat to new entrant. Then your third force is your substitute products. That means your competitor is offering something substitute. That means the product you are selling, there are some substitutes for that particular product. Like for example, for Colgate, the threat of substitute is Pepsodent or Close-Up. Okay. Then your fourth force is supplier bargaining power, and your fifth force is buyer bargaining power. Okay. So these are basically your 5 forces which have an effect on your business in the industry. Okay. Ye 5 forces hote hain jinka effect aapke business pe aata hai if you are entering into the industry. Or if you are competing in the industry. What are these 5 forces? Let us just first recapitulate. So first are your rivals, then your new entrants, then your substitute products, suppliers, and buyer's bargaining power. Okay, so these are your five forces. Now let's just read out each and every force in detail, and also we will study the effect of each force in detail. So first is your threat of new entrants. Now what is the threat of new entrant? That some new entry is coming into the same business in which you are in. Okay, so new entrants can reduce an industry's profitability because they add new product production capacity, leading to increase in supply of the product, sometimes even at a lower price, and can substantially erode existing firm's market share's position. However, new entrants are always a powerful source of competition. The new capacity and product range they bring in throws up a new competitive pressure. Now, new entry is coming, so they can take up some new products also. Okay, and some new product range and some new capacity also. That means the production capacity. So, the bigger the new entrant, the more severe the competitive effect. If anyone bigger than you will come into the industry, then of course you will have a very severe effect. It will have a very severe effect on your particular business. So new entrants also place a limit on prices and affect the profitability of existing player, which is known as price war. Now what happens? What is this price war? Let me just tell you. Suppose there are two competitors. One is your A, second is your B. Now what happens? B was the existing business and A was the new entry. So, B was selling a product for say rupees 100. Okay, now A, he was a new entry. So, what did he do? He brought the same product at rupees 90. A brought the same product at rupees 90. Now B was selling the product at 100, but A came as a new entry and sold the product at rupees 90. Now what will happen? B's profitability will get lower. So what will B do? B reduces the price to 85. And then A again reduced the price to 80. So this particular situation where the influence of competitors is on the price is known as your price war, and this affects the business profitability to a very, very great extent. Okay, for example, Reliance Jio. Now this is one of the example which you can quote in your exam. So Reliance Jio offered cheap prices when it entered into the telecom industry. Sorry. So as we all are aware that when Reliance Jio entered into the telecom industry, the prices of Reliance Jio were very, very low. But because the prices of the new entry, that means your Reliance Jio was so low that the other existing players like your Airtel, Vodafone, Idea, etc., they also had to reduce their price because their profitability affected. Okay, so they are saying that thus limiting the prices for existing players like Airtel, Voda. Firms' profitability tends to be higher when new firms are blocked from entering the industry. So they are saying that if you block, that means if you do not allow the new entrants to enter into the industry, then what happens? Your profitability tends to be higher. However, if there are new entrants into the industry, then your profitability may get lower because of this kind of price war. Okay, so to discourage new entrants means so that the new entrants do not enter, existing firms can try to raise barriers. Now this can be a separate question that can be asked you for 5 marks. Okay, so what are the common barriers to entry? That means you can impose some barriers so that the new entrants do not enter into the industry. So there are 7 barriers, and if the question comes for 5 marks also, then try to write all the 7 points so that you can get full 5 out of 5. Okay, so first barrier is your capital requirement, second is your economies of scale, third is your product differentiation, switching cost, brand identity, access to distribution channel, and possibility of aggressive retaliation by existing players. So let's just read it out each and every barrier one by one. So first is your capital requirement. Now if to produce any product, a lot of capital is required. So will a new entrant be easily able to enter the industry? No. Only that particular industry, only that particular business which has that level of capital which is required will be only able to enter the new industry. Okay, so when a large amount of capital is required to enter an industry, firms which do not have a sufficient amount of funds, that means firms which are lacking funds, are effectively barred from that industry, thus enhancing the profitability of existing firm. This line you can just pin it in your mind that if the new entrants are discouraged or if there are no new entrants into the industry, then the profitability of the existing business tends to be higher. Okay. For example, huge investments are required to build production facilities and establish brand awareness amongst people for entry into pharmaceutical industry. So this makes entry of new companies in this sector very difficult. So they are saying like in pharmaceutical industry, what happens? You need a lot of fund. So that is why new entrants, they are discouraged to enter because they need a lot of fund to enter into the industry. Now your second barrier can be economies of scale. What is economies of scale? If you produce a lots and lots of things, lots and lots of production, if you have a large amount of production basically, so what happens? The fixed cost remains constant, right? So if your fixed cost remain constant, so what happens is your per unit cost comes lower. Like suppose if I was producing two packets and I had a fixed cost of rupees 100, okay? I was producing only two packets, but if now I start producing 200 packets, then also my fixed cost will remain 100 only. So in that way, what will happen? The per unit cost of the product, jo ek product ki mujhe cost padegi, that will come lower because fixed cost is constant, right? Like suppose if I need to invest in a machinery and that machinery is suppose for rupees 100 lakh. Okay, if that particular machinery is for 100 lakhs, so once I have, invested in that particular machinery, so that machinery can produce unlimited amount of product. Okay, so whether I produce less product or whether I produce more product, my fixed cost is constant. I have already invested 100 lakhs. Okay, so what happens in that situation if I produce a large number of products? So, the per unit cost of each and every product tends to be lower and I remain in a profitable position. Now, suppose if you are entering into a new business. Aap log agar ek new business mein aa rahe ho, toh kya aapke liye possible hai ki aap ek saath hi bahut sara production kar lo? No, it is not possible because what happens? What if your product is not liked by the customers? And if you will produce a lots and lots of production of that particular product which is not liked by the customer, then you may feel loss. Okay, then you may face loss. So that is why the economies of scale can also be a barrier for the new entrants. So many industries are characterized by economic activities driven by economies of scale. Economies of scale refers to the decline in the per unit cost of production as the volume grows. So a large firm that enjoys economies of scale can produce high volume of goods at successfully lower cost. So this tends to discourage new entrants who are in expansion stage and have higher cost. Okay. So they are saying that the new entrants which are in the expansion stage or they have a higher cost, they will not be able to, achieve economies of scale. For example, in the semiconductor industry, large companies such as IBM, Intel, Samsung enjoy substantial economies of scale in the production of advanced microprocessor, communication chips, integrated circuits, personal computer. Now, because these are the industry, these are the businesses which are so many years, so that is why they are earning the advantage of economies of scale. But if I go in this particular industry, so will I be able to produce that much? No, because that is not guaranteed that my product will be liked by the customers. So that is why I will have to bear a high amount of cost and these competitors will bear a low amount of cost. Okay, low per unit cost. So that can be a barrier to the new entrant. Now third is your product differentiation. Product differentiation, what is product differentiation? Not in detail, we will discuss it in detail in the further part of chapter, but basically differentiation is something different from the competitor. That means which is not in the competitor's product and that particular thing is in my product, and also that different thing is valued by the customer. That is known as differentiation. So product differentiation refers to the physical or perceptual difference or enhancement that makes a product special or unique in the eyes of the customers. Okay. The firms in personal care and cosmetic industry try actively engage in product differentiation to enhance their product features. Like for example, in your creams, fairness creams, or you can say normal creams, face creams, there is a SPF and there is a sunscreen in that, and all that ultraviolet rays protection. So what does those creams include? These creams, these face creams, which have the elements which can protect you from UV rays. Okay, so these are actually a kind of differentiation because in the sun, the girls need the protection from the ultraviolet rays from the sun, which can protect their skin from tanning, right? So that is why this particular thing, which is in the face creams, is more preferred by girls and ladies. Okay, so this can be one type of differentiation. Similarly, for boys also, you can see a lot of features in the gadgets. So they prefer the gadgets which have more features. So those features can be a differentiation, an example of differentiation. Okay, so this differentiation can be the barrier to the new entrant, because it is not possible that new entrant also have something unique or something that is valued by the customer. Then switching cost. Now what happens when you are using a particular product from a lot of time, you develop a sense of trust with that particular product. For example, Colgate. Okay, Colgate is sold from so many years that people have a sense of trust on that particular product. So though there are a lot of competitors like Pepsodent and Close Up and all the other toothpaste, but still the the sale of Colgate is to a next level, and you cannot compare it with Pepsodent or any other toothpaste. So this is what: to succeed in an industry, new entrant must be able to persuade existing customer of other companies to switch to its product. Like if I am using toothpaste as a Colgate, if I use Colgate as my toothpaste, so I like that particular toothpaste. Now, if any other toothpaste enters into the industry, then I will be reluctant to change my toothpaste. I will say that I am comfortable with this product. Now, why should I change? So, this is what that if you are entering into the industry, then you should earn customers also. That means your the product with which you are entering, the customers should welcome that product. Because if the customers will not welcome that product, then you will not be able to succeed in that particular industry. So to make a switch, buyers may need to test a new firm's product, negotiate new purchase contracts, and train personal use to the equipment. Now another example can be the customers of Apple or Android. The person who uses Android mobile may not like Apple, and the Apple users may not like Android. So this is what they are comfortable with, that particular setup only. Okay, now if any new entrant comes and they tell them to change it, they will not change it. Okay, because they are familiar to that, they are comfortable with that. So this is only they are saying that you need to train personnel to use the equipment or modify facilities for product use. So buyers often incur substantial financial cost in switching between products when such switching costs are high. Buyers are often reluctant to change. So they are saying that if the buyers feel that the switching cost is high, that means if I am using a product A and I want to shift to product B, and for that I need to incur a high amount of cost, so that is actually my high switching cost. So if there will be high switching cost, then of course I am not going to change. So they have given one standard example. For example, high switching cost in moving away from Microsoft Windows operating systems used in personal computers and corporate servers powered the company's stunning growth over the past decade. In other words, Microsoft has marketed its operating system in such a manner that it is almost impossible for companies to sell a new operating system and break into the customer loyalty of Microsoft. Like you can see that Microsoft Windows operating system is means preferred by so many people, and no new entrant can, you know, change it. Or if any new entry comes also, then also more people will like this Microsoft Windows operating system only. So they are seeing that only, that if the customers feel that the switching cost is high or they need to, you know, get some special skills to use that new thing, so they will of course not change themselves. So this is what switching cost. Switching means badalna, okay, to change. Now brand identity. What is brand identity? The brand identity of products or service offered by existing firms can serve as another entry barrier. Like suppose the Apple iPhone, it is a kind of status symbol by some people. Similarly, that your Bullet, Royal Enfield, okay, this is also one status symbol. So brand identity is a biggest barrier to new industry, because no matter whatever competitor of Apple iPhone comes, but whatever is the position of iPhone will remain iPhone only. No Android can beat that position of Apple iPhone in the eyes of the customers. So this is what they are saying, that brand identity is particularly important for infrequently purchased products that carry a high unit cost to the buyer. New entrants often encounter significant difficulties in building up the brand identity, because to do so they must commit substantial resources over a long period of time. So the gestation period of customers' loyalty is quite high when customers identify themselves with existing brands. So they are saying that when the customers are dedicated towards a particular brand, so it becomes very difficult to earn customers' trust on our particular brand. Like suppose I make anything in a competition with Apple iPhone, then I'll need lots of years to earn the same level of symbol or same level of status as Apple has earned in today's date, right? So this is what they are saying. For example, during 1970s, Japanese companies such as Toyota, Nissan, Honda had to spend huge sums on new product development and promotional activities to overcome the American consumers' preference for domestic cars. It was a huge challenge for foreign car makers to break into the customers' base of Maruti Suzuki in the affordable family car segment, because people identified Maruti Suzuki as India's own family car company. So they are saying that these types of companies had to struggle a lot to come into customers' preference, because customers usually preferred Maruti Suzuki because they thought that Maruti Suzuki is our Indian brand. So American brands had to struggle a lot, okay, and they had to do a lot of promotional activities. So this was one kind of barrier to the new industry. Then comes the last two barriers. First is your access to distribution channels. Now, unavailability of distribution channels for new entrants poses another significant barrier. Despite the growing power of internet, many firms may continue to rely on their control for physical distribution channels to create a barrier to entry for rivals. Often existing firms have significant influence over distribution channel and can retard or restrict their use by new firms. For example, because of control over distribution channel in India by HUL, Hindustan Unilever Limited is such a big industry, such a big company, P&G, Godrej, small entrepreneurs find it very difficult to sell their product through existing channel. Now they are saying that the distribution channel, that is with some big companies like HUL, P&G, so that distribution channel is very, very difficult for the small entrepreneurs also. Okay, distribution channel basically means the delivery of your particular product to the customers. Similarly, with the advent of Patanjali and its strong nationwide distribution channel, new Ayurvedic FMCG companies are facing a channel. You can see Patanjali in each and every city, and not only one store. There are multiple stores in multiple locations in a particular city also. So this is one of the distribution channel feature of Patanjali. Now the competitors of Patanjali, like FMCG companies, they are facing a challenge to reach to the customers, to the position, to the extent Patanjali has reached. It is very, very difficult for them Okay, so this is one of the barrier to new entry, because for that you also need such a strong distribution channel. Now, possible of aggressive retaliation. Now, sometimes the mere threat to aggressive retaliation by incumbents or existing firm can deter entry of new firms into an existing firm. For example, introduction of products by a new firm may lead incumbents firm, incumbents means existing firm, to reduce their product price and increase their advertising budget. So what they are saying, like in the starting example I told you na, that if there were two businesses A and B, so B sold the product for rupees 100 and A came and sold the product for 90. Now what did B do? He reduced the price to 85 and increased the advertisement. Okay, and increase the advertisement. So what happened? The same way Hindustan Unilever and Palmolive spent huge sums of money in advertisement to find Patanjali's Dant Kanti toothpaste. So they are saying, now because they have reduced their price also, they are advertising so much also. So what can happen? This can become a barrier. This can become a barrier to it. Why? Because when they are advertising so much, when they are also lowering the price from A, so no matter how much A also lowers its price, their advertisement cost will be more. Okay, because they are spending so much on advertisement, so their reach will be more. So this can be a aggressive retaliation by the existing firms. That means now if they'll reduce 80, they'll again reduce it to 75 and they will again increase their advertisement. So what will happen? Their reach will also remain high, and also the customers will also prefer them. So they will not let new entrant to come into the industry. ठीक है, मतलब तुमने इतना कम किया, मैंने और कम कर दिया, तुमने इतना कम किया, मैंने और कम कर दिया. So this cycle will keep on going on until and unless A will be discouraged to come into the new industry. So these were the barriers. We will discuss the other forces from the next class. I hope that you could understand. I'll try to sum up this chapter in two or three more classes. Okay. And the total strategic management syllabus from my end, I guess it can take 17 hours approx, 16 to 17 hours. I cannot be so sure that how much hours it will take to complete the whole strategic management syllabus, but I'll try my best to complete all the chapters. So I'm ending this video here, and for any doubt, you can comment down or you can also participate in the Telegram channel. I'll drop the